Hello, my name's Julian Edgar, and I'm the author of this book, Vehicle Aerodynamics, Testing, Modification and Development. And the book is aimed at those with road cars, racing cars, and also alternative transport. What I want to do in today's video is talk about measuring aerodynamic lift or downforce using suspension height sensors. Let's take a look. It's an extremely effective way of doing it. No wind tunnel needed. So, first of all, nearly all road cars develop aerodynamic lift. We'll talk about racing cars in a moment, but talk initially about road cars. So, as you go faster, the car actually effectively weighs less. It's getting lifted up off the road. And if you're thinking, well, how could that actually be the case? Just look at the airflow pattern over this particular car and compare it to an aircraft wing. This car's got airflow underneath the car, which is good, but it's got a lot of airflow that wraps over those upper curves. And when airflow wraps over curves, it develops a lift force. Now, in this car, all that lift force being developed with that curved airflow has to be more than made up for with the airflow under the car. And typically, it's not the case. Nearly all road cars have lift. The number that do not is like 0.00001% or something of that sort. Now, what about race cars? Well, professional race cars obviously have downforce and lots of downforce, but a lot of amateur race cars, I would suggest, also have plenty of lift, because when you look at their aerodynamic appendages, their wings, which are often stalled, their under trays, which are often not even there, you know that that car has got plenty of lift. But you don't have to guess, you can actually measure it. And this video, the first of three videos of measuring lift or downforce, shows one of the simplest ways of doing so. Now, what we do is we say to ourselves, well, if the body is developing lift, it's going to rise on its springs as you go faster, the suspension springs. The ride height is going to increase as you go quicker if the bodywork is developing lift. So how can we measure ride height? Because that'll tell us whether we're getting lift or if the bodywork is getting squashed down on the springs, if we're getting downforce. Well, one way is to use ride height sensors. Now, ride height sensors are used in lots of cars. All cars with air suspension from the factory have ride height sensors. These are actually from an older Range Rover, the ones that I use. And these ones typically are very simple. They're just a potentiometer, a pot, like a volume control on an old-fashioned radio with an arm attached to it. And the arm attaches to the bodywork, and the rest of the body is attached to the suspension, or the other way around. And as the ride height increases, the arm simply rotates the pot. It's as obvious and easy as that. Now, potentiometer-based, pot-based ride height sensors are particularly good because they're analog. They have no digital steps. They're infinite range, and therefore that gives them very, very great resolution. If you're not familiar with that electronics understanding, don't worry about it. But a pot like this can show you even tiny changes in ride height. All right, so we attach one of these to the suspension, which we'll look at more detail in a moment. And then we measure the average ride height. And if the average ride height gets bigger as you go faster, it's because the bodywork is being lifted on the springs. That's lift, aerodynamic lift. And if the ride height gets less as you go faster, the bodywork is being squashed down on the springs, and therefore that's indicative of downforce. Sounds simple? It is simple. Very, very simple, but it can measure even tiny changes. So here's one of those Range Rover sensors attached to, or in the process of being attached to, the front suspension on one of my cars. Now, here's something you don't underestimate. Notice how, firstly, the pot sensor has been attached to a custom bracket that I made that is attached to the chassis of the car. The bodywork needs to be rigid. Notice how I've put a little miniature ball joint on the end of that arm. I threaded the arm to take a 6mm ball joint. And then notice there's another ball joint that's been attached to the suspension arm with a link, a stiff link in between. If you are using ride height sensors to measure aerodynamic lift and downforce, everything must be rigid and there must be no slop in the linkages. You really must do a very good job if you are able to measure even tiny changes. And that's one of the disadvantages of this approach. It's not 2 seconds to fit a sensor like this. It might be, for me, I'm a slow worker, it might be 3 or 4 hours. You also don't want the suspension to move through a greater range than the pot can move. You want it to stay in the linear range of the pot, which on these is just between these white dots that I've marked. There and there, so you can see here we're at full suspension droop. And so to really find that out, in some cars you even need to take the springs out and move the suspension through its full travel. So it's all doable, it's all doable by an amateur, but you want to do a really good job installing ride height sensors of this sort if you are going to be able to measure things accurately. So then we get to the next step. We've got a sensor, we've got an output from the sensor. In this case, because it's a pot sensor, we just feed it a regulated 5 volts and then we get a voltage that varies. Minimum's 0, maximum will be 5, but it'll be less of a range than that. But as you're driving along, the wheel's going like this over every bump. And so how on earth can you measure the average ride height? Well, we need to smooth the output signal. And here I've got an example. The blue trace here shows the unsmooth signal coming straight from the sensor. I just simulated this by turning it, but you can see it's got lots of jagged lines and stuff. Whereas here we have the smooth signal, and you can see it's taking an average. It's taking an average of the very fast movements that are being caused by the pot attached to the suspension. Now, a smoothing circuit like that in electronic terms is actually very, very simple. You can see it here, it really is only 1, 2, 3, 4 components and a multimeter. It's really very, very easy to actually build. And if you're not familiar with electronics, anyone familiar with electronics could build this for, you know, $1 or $2. It's very, very cheap as well. So now we've got a sensor attached. We've got its output smooth so that we can actually see average ride height, not all the perturbations caused by going over bumps and so on. And so when we're looking at the average, if you go faster and the average gets smaller, gets lower, it's because it's getting squashed down, the bodywork, downforce. And if the average gets bigger, it's because the bodywork's being lifted, lift. So you can see it's not hard to understand. So how well does it work? Well, here's an example I did on my son's car that he then had, which was a Subaru Impreza. And we did 3 tests. We did one with no wing or spoiler on the back. Didn't bother showing a photo of that. We did one with the factory spoiler on the back, and we did another run with a rip-off example of a STI spoiler wing. It wasn't a genuine one, but it's exactly the same shape. Now, over here, we have the results of reading the signal output from that sensor, which was on the rear suspension only. And up the vertical axis, I've just left it in volts that were coming out of the sensor. The higher the voltage, the higher the ride height. And then across the bottom axis, I've got speed, 0 to 150 kilometres an hour. And I've drawn in a line of best fit. Now, with no wing or spoiler, you always start really slowly, so there's no aerodynamics actually much in play. So we did a test run at about 25 kilometres an hour. As you go faster, the ride height increases. This car, with no rear wing or spoiler, develops rear lift. Okay, just drive down the road, going at it, well, in this case, I only went to about 120 kilometers an hour on this one, and you could see that the readings were getting higher. I didn't say, but you just read the readings from that smoothing circuit with any old multimeter. It's certainly accurate enough and good enough in quality for this sort of application. Okay, so no wing or spoiler, the rear of the Subaru develops lift, easily able to be determined with the standard suspension and just with this added ride height sensor. What about with the standard spoiler back on the car? Again, you do a base run. Always do a base run because the weight of the car is changing, remember, if you're taking bits on and off. So do a base run at low speed where the aerodynamic effects are not going to change ride height, you know, measurably, and then go faster. Now, with the standard spoiler back on, the car basically develops no lift at all. If anything, it develops the tiniest amount of downforce. That rear spoiler on that car actually makes a measurable difference. So that's pretty interesting. What happens if we put the STI combined spoiler and wing? And it is both. The bottom part is a spoiler, which helps develop pressure against it, so pushing on the boot, trunk lid, and also the rear window. And then the wing well above it would actually develop its own downforce. Does it all work? Yes, it does. Again, we do a base run at slow speed. We go faster and faster and faster. And this time I did go faster. Went up to 150 kilometers an hour. And the suspension gets lower and lower and lower as you go faster. The rear suspension. So it's being pushed down. It's being pushed down by that combined rear wing, rear spoiler. This is a technique that works. It's demonstrated as working and can detect even tiny changes once you have that smoothing circuit in place. You can't run it without the smoothing circuit because you just have figures on the meter that is jumping all over the place. But with the smoothing circuit, it will change only slowly as you go faster, which reflects reality. So where does that leave us? Well, start with nearly all cars develop aerodynamic lift. 99.99999% of road cars develop lift. And lift is bad. I haven't said why, but it reduces stability, reduces braking performance, reduces handling performance. But what if you're watching this video and you say, well, I've got an amateur racing car and that develops downforce? Okay, well, fine. You can use exactly this technique to measure how much downforce and whether it really is developing downforce. So some cars do develop downforce. You'd be aware of those probably as well as I. You know, some of the exotics, some of the Porsches with big wings and so on, factory wings. But taking this technique, using this technique, measuring whether a car is developing lift or downforce is easy, it's accurate, and it's cheap. If you buy those sensors secondhand, as I typically do, and you get someone to make up the electronic circuit or make it up yourself, you're talking maybe, you know, $100 to be able to measure accurately each end of the car, whether it develops lift or whether it develops downforce. And the measurement can be done on the road and it can be done on the track. Now, if you have a car with really stiff suspension, you're either going to have to go very fast to get sufficient movement of the suspension to measure, or you're going to have to replace those stiffer springs with softer springs just while you do this straight line testing. And if you're running a racing car, you'd be quite competent and happy and no doubt skilled at changing suspension springs. It's not a big deal. Incidentally, there's the photo of the sensor attached on the rear suspension of the Subaru. It's a little bit different to how I did it on the Honda, but you know, the similarities are obvious. Incidentally, because this was going to stay on the car, I slipped a little bit of rubber inner tube off a bicycle inner tube over the top and cable tied it in place just to protect the exposed ball joints. So what else can you do? Lift downforce measurement by suspension sensors can be used to show whether the car develops lift or downforce, something that 99.99% of people have no idea about. It can also be used to show the lift balance. So typically you want, if the car is developing lift, you want the front to develop a little bit more lift than the back to give high speed stability understeer, a topic I explore in quite a lot of detail in the book because it's quite a contentious yet very interesting area. If you've got a car with downforce at both ends, you want the back of the car to have more downforce than the front, and measuring at each end, you can obviously see that. You don't have to guess or calculate or imagine it. You can actually directly measure it. And finally, if you are making modifications by measuring lift downforce using a suspension sensor or sensors, you can immediately see what is the effect of a wing. You can try different angles of that wing. You can try different shapes, profile, sizes, and see the exact result on the car you're dealing with, not on another car, but on your car. You can see the effect of spoilers. You can see the effect of splitters, air dams, under tray. All of these things suddenly move from guesswork to being measurable in quite a lot of detail. And I didn't mention it. Let's say you have got a car which is developing downforce. You can even quantify how many kilograms of downforce you're getting at a certain speed. You simply take off the wing, load the car with weights over the axle line to get the same degree of deflection at the same speed as you were achieving when you did have the wing in place. So you can even quantify downforce, and if you remove weights, quantify lift as well. Takes away all the guesswork. It's accurate, it's cheap, it's precise, and it is achievable. Covered in my book, Vehicle Aerodynamics, Testing, Modification, and Development, The book's available from Amazon in your country. And not only do I look at suspension height sensors, I also look at laser height sensors, which are quick and easy to attach to the car. And I also look at measuring trailing vortex direction, which sounds very esoteric, but on certain cars will also tell you whether you're getting lift or downforce. It's 500 pages, it's 800 images, all in full color, so it's not a cheap book, but this is the content that will allow you to make aerodynamic development and modification that actually works. No guesswork, actual measurement of what is going on. Thank you.